descending, because the more you descend, the more guilty you become. The more guilty you become, the more excitements you need, the more pleasures you need to escape into it, to deny the truth that you're dying. And if you remember the sentence of death to Adam, you shall surely die. Well, this is everything that human race feels when they're guilty. A sentence of death follows them. Spiritually, psychologically, they feel a doom, they call it boredom. It's like a death. And if we're not doing something exciting, something wrong, something pseudo-life-giving, we feel depressed, and there's only so much pleasure and excitement you can afford, and then it catches up with you again. It becomes a morbid condition where your conscience follows you as a sentence of death. And your denial of death has brought this about. And all the pleasures, all the pleasurable things you do, and all the wrong decisions you make, and all the wrong friends you heap up to yourself, you see, this is productive of death. So the life that we live leads to death. There's a life that leads to life, and there's a life that leads to death. But the point is, people are afraid of death because we, in our egotism, part of that descent has something to do with wanting to be a god or being immortal, thinking that we are not just a miserable worm living a short life and being eaten by worms, you see, at the grave. We like to think of ourselves as gods, living forever. Young people think they can live forever. And then they spend their life in the wrong way, like the prodigal son. And when you get to past 30, it begins to dawn that you've kind of wasted your substance. But that time you're lost. And then you need religion, or you need drugs or something. And then medicine comes to the rescue, trying to keep you alive. Who wants to live with tubes in your ears and 50 pills a day? And what kind of life is it? A healthy plant is a healthy plant. You can keep it alive by spraying, but what use is a plant that you have to keep alive by spraying? It has no futility, no value, not even to itself, right? So there's a life that leads to death, and there are people who prey on the dying and lead. There's a parasitical type of human being who, sociopathic, psychopathic kind of people, and they usually emerge as leaders. Look at the world. The whole human race has a history of enslavement. But if you look at your own life, this society is descending into slavery. Each one of us are addicted to something. But it helps to comfort us and justify, well, this is the way I am. I smoke because I choose to. Now, what this person's really saying is, I'm not really free. I'm a slave of my cigarette, my drug, whatever it is, but it's something I choose to do, it's me. What he's doing is making a compulsion look like a free will choice, therefore he doesn't have to see he's a slave. See, all of us who are slaves and living up in our pleasure, where our pleasures are serving us, are really enslaving us, but we don't see that. We don't want to see this enslavement part. We don't want to see that this life that we're living is only an ego life, and an ego life leads to death, and to all kinds of diseases and complications, a nightmarish existence. And you see, if you look at society, you see different various stages of that. The horrible things that people do to each other, the horrible things that people do to each other themselves. And as they get towards the end of this life that leads to death, and there's no more, they can't deal with their conscience anymore, and the pain is so severe, then you've got Dr. Kevorkian to help you, the angel of death, to help you die with dignity, you see? And what kind of dignity is that? We're calling this miserable death a person who can't stand his living any longer, who's fed up with life, who thinks life is a punishment. He thinks that death is a safe relief, and it isn't. Because there may be something on the other side. And everyone who has suicidal thoughts has a voice telling them, you know, you deserve better than that. You really don't. But you see, why don't you kill yourself and get it over with? That's the voice that talks to us as you descend into the depths. You keep denying and denying and denying, and you go deeper and deeper into your flesh, and you almost can hear the other side talking to you. It becomes your voice of conscience, but always leading you to the other side. You know, life is like a bridge, a rope bridge between two dimensions, and our life is to move to one side or the other, to right or to wrong, to truth or to denying it. And when that rope bridge breaks down and you die, you find yourself on one side or the other of the chasm. All the doctors in the world will not save you. All the religion in the world will not save you. Because all you need is the secret of being restored to the original state from which Adam fell. He had a choice between right and wrong, but we don't have that choice. But we have something better than that. Our choice is better than that. It's not really a choice. It's a salvation from a choice. This is the basis of Christianity, by the way. I'm Jewish. I understand one of our guys made it, you know. I'm a Jewish person that believes that Christ was the Messiah, but I'm still Jewish. Why do I want to believe in a bearded rabbi who obviously only learned what he read? I believe in a person who intuitively knows. I'm a man who knows things by intuition. I can know the scripture, not by bragging. It sounds like I'm bragging, I know, but we can all know it. In a lightning flash, a porpoise is a porpoise is a porpoise, and a great white shark is a great white shark. They both have their natures, and they're true to their natures. They have no choice. I can leave my old nature behind if I'm not happy with it. Some people are happy with the nature they inherit. But man is born of nature, then of spirit. Adam was created differently, and he has this choice between ego, playing God, and loving God. See, that was the separation. So, and that inheritance comes down to us because Eve was the mother of all living. She was the mother of the first ego, Adam, right? And she had a mother. Don't women have to mother egos? And therefore, there was no father. In effect, the relationship between Adam, the first man, and his creator was gone. He was already subject to the forces in his wife. She needs saving. Women need saving by the love of man. But now a woman is cast in the miserable role of supporting the animal ego of a man. And the more she loves him, the bigger animal he becomes. He becomes a wimp for love, or when he discovers that he has been had, he's a slave of the demanding woman, he tries to rebel with violence, O.J. Simpson. Death, murder. See? So, but at least Adam had the choice, and there are no fathers. Even if a father is there, he isn't. He's a slave of her, and she's a slave of what you cannot see, of death.